Zone 316. Somebody read out, please.
John 3, verse 16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life.
Okay, these are the three terms that I want you to focus. Number one, in order to understand this, we need to understand what does it mean by begotten, and what does it mean by the sent, and also what does it mean by the term Son. So when you understand this, then it will be very easy for you to understand what was Jesus trying to say to his disciples. Why was Jesus saying that for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son? Why was he saying that in this manner? So we know that John 3, 16, and also you may continue read verse 17 as well. That's 3:17 as well.
Saint John 3, verse 17. For God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved.
Okay, so underline again sin. You can see in John 3, 17. What does it say again? It said sin, right? For God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. So in other words, that it is very clear that Christ is not condemning the world, but to save the world. Not to condemn, but to save. Now there's a big difference between condemnations and saving. If you just condemn it, then what's the point? So the ultimate purpose of God's becoming incarnated as a man, or God revealing himself as a Son, is not to condemn, but to save. But the point here is, what does it mean? Because in John 3, 16 and 17, and also in John 5, 30. Now you can turn the Bible again to John 5, 30. Okay, John 5, 30. Are you there? Okay, read out.
John 5, verse 13. I can of my own self do nothing. As I hear, I judge, and my judgment is just, because I seek not my own will, but the will of the Father which had sent me.
Alright, so Jesus also said that the Father which had sent me. Alright, here again in the 5:30, that Jesus said the Father sent me. Alright. So I want you to understand what does it mean by this sent, then you automatically understand what was Jesus saying. Number one, we should always keep in mind that as far as the Bible is concerned, and I have said it several times, and many times I've repeated it over again and again, but why I'm repeating it? Because I want you to understand, and I want you to know this. Today the world has been separated. Many Christians are not coming together. The churches are being separated from one another. Instead of becoming one, because nowhere the Bible said you'll be two or three, four, five. The central message of God is that let them be one as we are one. So God is only concerned about our unity. Regardless of our background and respective of our languages and cultures and customs and our background, but still God wants us to be one. And as far as the Bible is concerned, in the Bible there is only one church. There is only one Lord. There is one faith, one baptism, one hope of glory. Matthew 16, verse 18, that Jesus calls the church is my church. Isn't it? It denotes in my churches. So when you study the New Testament and the Old Testament, it's very clear, as far as the scripture is concerned, there is one church. Amen. And all the believers, all the saints, whose sins are washed away by the blood of Christ, God wants us to be in His church, in that one church. So as far as denominations are concerned, according to the Holy Bible, there is no denomination. And if you break it even the word denomination, it means no denomination. Because you're saying denomination. Alright, if you break it in the denomination, then still it means no denomination. So denomination is not absolutely man-made doctrine. It's a man-made organization. And therefore, as a Bible-believing Christian, as the follower of Jesus Christ, we should be concerned about denomination, but we should be concerned about the one church that Christ built. And in order to remember of that church, the church that Christ built, we need to obey. Amen. The New Testament plan of God's salvation, which is clearly found in Acts 2:38, where that Peter said, "Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ. And whosoever obeyed the commandments of God, according to Acts 2, verse 47, the Lord Jesus Christ added them unto the church." So that how we become the members of the church of Christ, or the church that Jesus Christ built. Now, very interesting is, what we need to understand is that in order to save us, or in order to be our Savior, the Bible tells us over again and again that God manifested Himself in flesh. So therefore, the manifestation of God in the flesh is called Son of God. So the term sons always indicates the humanity. I want you to turn with me to the 2 Corinthians. Chapter 5 and verse 19. Okay, all of you read together.
To wit, that God was in Christ, reconciling the world unto Himself, nor imputing their trespasses unto them, and hath committed unto us the word of reconciliation.
Read one more time, all of you together.
To wit, that God was in Christ, reconciling the world unto Himself, nor imputing their trespasses unto them, and hath committed unto us the word of reconciliation.
Alright, thank you, my friends. Everybody underline, circle it, Himself. Amen? So what does it mean? What does it mean by this verse 92? Wit, that God was in Christ, reconciling the world unto Himself. You see? So what does it mean by Himself? In Himself. That means that God did not send another God in order to be our Savior, or in order to save the world, that the creator of the heaven and the earth, the God of the Bible, the God of Abraham, Jacob, and Isaac, was manifested in the flesh. Or in other words, the Bible clearly tells us that God manifested Himself in the flesh. So therefore, here it says in verse 19, to wit, that God was in Christ, reconciling the world unto Himself, not imputing their trespasses unto them, and had committed unto us the word of reconciliation. Alright, so now we have the ministry of reconciliation. Today, we are preaching the gospel, so that the man and women would have their reconciliation, they can be reconciled with the Father, they can be reconciled with the Almighty God, whose name is Jesus Christ. And also we can see, not just from the 2 Corinthians, as well as from the 1 Timothy chapter 3, verse 16. You may read out that portion again. Let's hear again from the 1 Timothy chapter 3, verse 16. All the clearly tells us that God manifested Himself in flesh, or in the flesh. Okay, let's read out verse 16. All of you can read together, I think that'll be better.
And without controversy, great is the mystery of godliness.
God was manifest in the flesh, justified in the spirit, seen of angels, preached unto the Gentiles, believed on the word, received up into glory.
Amen, amen, hallelujah. So you may underline it, God was manifested in the flesh. So the Bible clearly makes it very clear that God manifested himself. Or in other words, the Holy Scripture reveals and declares that God manifested himself in the flesh. As far as this 2 Corinthians 5:19 is concerned, and also the 1 Timothy 3:16 is concerned. So in other words, he gave himself, and therefore he did not send someone else. So if you say that God sends, God the Father sent the second God, or the second person in the Godhead, Jesus Christ, or another God, then you are absolutely missing, all right, what God wants to reveal to you. Then that is not what the scripture says. And also that violates. And the moment when you say that God is sending another God, that means you are violating. You are violating the Holy Scriptures. You're attacking not man, but you're attacking the Almighty God Himself. Because we can see that the very nature of God from the Old Testament is that there is one God. And therefore, as far as the Bible is concerned from the Old Testament, it is absolutely clear that as far as God is concerned, God is absolutely one. Okay, nowhere the Bible says God is one in three persons, in four persons, and two persons. So all such terms and terminologies are nowhere to be found in the Bible. So therefore, the moment when you say God sent another God, that means you are directly attacking the Almighty God. You are attacking His words. You are attacking His Holy Scripture. Because nowhere in the Holy Scriptures you will ever come across those phrases, those terms. Nowhere is written in the Bible. So that means that whoever says that God sent the second God or sent another God, that he or she is just, all right, attacking the Holy Scripture, nothing else. The very person who says those things are not attacking me, but is attacking the Almighty God, because nowhere the scripture says that God sent another God. So what we always need to keep in mind, there is a distinction. Many people fail to understand the distinctions of the Father and Son. That's a problem. Now, why is that the people often misunderstood this? It's because they fail to understand the distinction between the Father and Son. Or you can say Spirit and flesh. So when you fail to understand the distinction between the Father and Son, the Spirit and flesh, then you will end up saying that maybe God sent another God. But what always you need to remember is that in the Holy Scriptures, there is no such terms as this triune God, Trinity, Trimurti, the first God, the second God, the third God, no such terms or terminologies are nowhere to be found in the Holy Scripture. With all due respect to the people who may believe in that kind of doctrine, because many times when we are speaking of the truth, some people, you know, take it in a very negative sense. Immediately they are assuming that maybe the ABTS seminary is attacking me. Don't take it personally. The seminary does not attack anybody. We don't attack any church. That's not our mission. Our mission is to equip the saints of God, the godly men and women, so that they can become a better servant. So that they can serve the Almighty God. So the very purpose of this existence of this seminary is to equip men and women for the church and the kingdom of the Lord Jesus, that's it. So in other words, we are not attacking anybody, but as we are practicing the Bible, and as we are a Bible student, Bible-believing people, Bible-believing church, nowhere we can come across those terms and terminologies, such as triune, Says it's the first person, the second person, the third person. And if you talk about the persons, now even those terms and terminology, nowhere it's found in the Holy Scriptures. And when we even study about the Lord Jesus Christ, according to Revelation chapter 1 verse 8, and Revelation 22 verse 12 and 13, it's very clear that Jesus Christ can never be the second, he will always be the first. Amen, hallelujah. Because the Bible said Jesus the first and the last. He's the Alpha and Omega. He's the beginning and the end. What does it mean by Alpha? The first. The first and the last. And then according to the Old Testament, the God who claimed that I'm the first and the last says that beside me there is no other God. For example, in Isaiah 44 verse 6, thus is the Lord, the King of Israel, the Lord of hosts, that I am the first and the last, beside me there is no God. For example, in Isaiah 41 and verse 43 verse 11, I am the Lord, beside me there is no Savior. So when you study from the Old Testament, you can clearly understand there is only one Savior, there is only one Father, there is only one God. So the one Father, the one God, the one Savior claim and declare himself that I am the first and I am the last, beside me there is no God. And when you compare that with the New Testament, since it's from Revelation chapter 1 verse 8, and all the Revelation chapter 22, verse 12 and 13, you can clearly understand the first and the last is not. Alright? Some other, the first God or the Father, but according to the New Testament, the first and the last is our Lord Jesus Christ Himself. So what does it prove? It proved that Jesus is in His deity. In His deity, Jesus Christ is truly the God of the Old Testament. There is no way to sum up. The only conclusion that you will conclude is that Jesus Christ is the Old Testament Yahweh. Or in other words, the Old Testament Yahweh or Jehovah, who is not as the God of Abraham, Jacob, and Isaac, is indeed the New Testament Jesus. Because when you compare both the Old Testament and New Testament, and that is the conclusion that everybody will come up. Because there is no other way out. If you allow the scripture to interpret the scriptures, if you simply allow the Bible to speak for itself, if you simply allow the Bible or the scripture to interpret the scripture, then the only conclusion that everybody will come to conclude is that Jesus is the God of Abraham, Jacob, and Isaac. So the God of the Old Testament, who is not as the God of Abraham, Jacob, and Isaac, claims that, declares in Isaiah 44 verse 6, that He's the first and the last, and the beginning and the end, and beside Him there is no God. But when you study in Revelation 22 verse 12, He said, behold, I come quickly. I am the first and I am the last, I am the beginning and the end, I am the first and the last, oh my God. So that means, if you simply allow the Bible to interpret the Bible, then you will come to this conclusion that Jesus Christ is the God of the Old Testament. Praise the Lord, hallelujah. He is the one true God. And we are not ashamed to say that He is our Father, He is our God, He is our all in all, He is everything, hallelujah. You know that one of the new songs that's released by the Bethel Music, the goodness of God. I like the lyrics because the lyrics clearly say, I've known you as my Father. Amen. But many denominational preachers will hate that song because they have no problem as far as you say that Jesus is God. But the moment when you say that Jesus is the Father, that time they have a problem. Because they are following the Roman Catholicism triangles. That Mammon doctrine, which was invented and adopted since the 325 AD. The 325 AD, the Nicene Councils. So the people who are, you know, upholding the Roman Catholicism creeds and the traditions would always, you know, would not appreciate those kind of lyrics. Because if you say that Jesus, I know you as my Father, and we know you as our Father, then they will have a problem, because they say it to their own children, their own students, and to their church member that you can call Jesus the Father, but never say he's a saint. Sorry. You can call him Jesus Christ as God, but never say that Jesus is the Father. Do you remember that, which I drew the triangle before? The same triangles, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. So the Father is God, the Son is God, all right? All of them are God. So this is the Roman Catholicism, the doctrine of Trinity, which was invented and adopted since the 325 AD. So according to this Roman Catholicism, they said the Father is God. And they also said the Son is also God. The Holy Spirit is also God. But the Father is not the Son. And the Son is not the Father. The Son is not the Holy Ghost. The Holy Spirit is not the Son. The Father is not the Holy Ghost. Holy Ghost is not the Father. They all are separate persons. But yet, they agree or they dwell as one. It sounds very good from a human standpoint. Quite interesting. But the question is this terms and such is this terminologies are used in the Bible? Are these terminologies has been quoted from the Holy Scripture? So the answer is no, my friend. Even if you study about the terms and terminologies, it's terms and terminology, it's conceptions, it's doctrine, ideas, all that, even the terminologies are nowhere to be found in Holy Scripture. The terms as God is three persons, three in one. All these terms is nowhere to be found in the Holy Scripture. Even the word Trinity or Triunity or so-called the Trimurti is nowhere in the Holy Scripture. Nowhere in the Bible. So as a Bible-believing people, we are saying that if we are serious about our faith, if we are serious about who we are, if we are serious about our religions, if we are serious about the God we worship, then all we are saying is that let's stick with the Bible terms and terminologies. Let us be contained. Let us learn to be contained with the Bible terms and terminologies. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Is anything wrong in saying that? Absolutely not. On the other hand, we the evangelical Christians, we the Bible-believing Christians, we often say that we believe in the sola scriptura, which means scripture alone. Then why do we need all these terms and terminologies? And by the way, the terms and terminology, even its concept and doctrine was not even developed by our so-called evangelicals or, you know, other Bible-believing church. All these terms and terminologies was developed and adopted by none other than the Roman Catholic Church. In other words, the Catholics, they all acknowledged and they said, yes, we did it. The Emperor Constantine and then the Catholics, theologians, Athanasians. They invented and they adopted this Babylonian doctrines called the Babylonian Trinity was modified and included in the Catholics' doctrine. And since the 325 AD, a decree was made saying that if you want to be saved or if you want to live your life, if you do not want to miss your eternity, if you want to be saved, then stick with these our creed. So even the Pharisee creed clearly says that whosoever will be saved must believe in Trinity and Trinity in unity. But before that they say the Roman Catholic faith is this. So they made a declaration. They said the Roman Catholic faith is this, that we believe in Trinity and Trinity in unity. Wait a minute. Norwich says the Protestant faith is this. Even the creed itself says the Roman Catholic faith is this. It does not say the Protestant, Evangelical, or the Baptist faith is this. Nowhere it says. Then why are we believing in that Roman Catholic doctrine? Unless you are a Catholic member, normally if you want to include yourself and you want to become a member of the Catholic Church, that's your choice. I can understand if someone from the Catholic Church would say, if a Catholic priest would say, no matter what you say, since we all believe in the traditions, we are not a biblical Christian. Now remember, the Catholic will never say we are biblical Christians. As far as I know, they never said it. Because they know themselves and even the world knows that they believe in traditions. In the Catholic Church, the traditions, in a practical manner, it's above the Holy Scripture. Traditions matters. Man's traditions, the commandments of man, the man-made doctrines, and the tradition is very, very important in the Catholic Church. Right, at least if a Catholic priest would say, and maybe we can understand. Because they often say we are not biblical, we are traditional Christians. We are Roman Catholics. We are the Roman Catholic Church. And therefore, as a Catholic member, and as a Catholic priest, or as a Catholic father, or the Pope, or the Archbishops, I must stick with, I must uphold our creeds and our traditions. But whereas we the Protestants, the first slogan that we always raised during the Reformation time was that we believe in sola scriptura. What simply means in Latin, sola means one, scriptura means scripture. In other words, we are saying that we believe in scripture alone. Sola fide means faith alone. Sola gratia means grace alone. That marks us, that separates us from the Roman Catholic Church. That whoever says that we believe in the sola scriptura, ultimately they are known as the Protestant Church. So we value the Bibles. We said the Bible said like this. And therefore, even Martin Luther in the Romans, in 317, Martin Luther nailed the 95 points or the 95 theses at the Wittenberg Church, on the Catholic Church, at the door of the Wittenberg Church in Wittenberg, in Germany. So the 95 theses clearly states that salvation is not through the traditions or not this indulgence are not through the penance, but salvation is only through faith, based on Romans chapter 1 verse 17. And therefore he cried out and said, the Bible said like this, and then why are we selling for salvation? Why are we practicing in these indulgences, in these traditions, such as being the penance and indulging in all kinds of indulgence, and loving the people to believe in indulgence? Why? So the moment after that, when Martin Luther started to say the Bible said like this, and the moment he started to say that the Bible said like this, or the scripture said like this, since then his life was he's receiving a life threat from the Catholic Church. So after some time, he had to fled from the place, from the German, in order to save his life. And the people who also believed in the Bible, the people who believe the Bible is superior than the tradition, the Bible is superior than the main doctrine, all of them started to follow the Martin Luther, John Calvin, and Zwingli, etc. because all three of them are not in Reformation's leaders. Anyway, that's about the history's history. But what I want to just, you know, reveal to you, why was there a separation from the Catholic Church? Because the Martin Lutheran friends emphasized the Bible teaching. They believe the Bible is more superior, that the Scripture is more superior than the traditions. The Scripture is more superior. God's Word is more superior than the man-made teachings and the tradition. Therefore, my friends, as a Bible-believing Christians, what do you value? Do you still value the traditions or the Bible teaching? Because you can study from Genesis chapter 1, and you can study till Revelation 22, you can read it and you can study back and forth for the 10,000 years, and you will never come across those terms of terminology such as God is three persons, triune God, Trinity, Trimurti, three, one, one, three, all these terms and terminologies nowhere to be found in those scriptures. So as therefore, as a Bible-believing Christian, we must be contained with what the Scripture says. And there is also an exhortation from Jude. Let's read before we come to the explanations. Let's read from the Epistle of Jude, generally known as the General Epistle of Jude. Read Jude chapter 1, verse 3.
Jude chapter 1, verse 3. Beloved, when I gave all diligence to write unto you of the common salvation, it was needful for me to write unto you and exhort you that you should earnestly contend for the faith which was once delivered unto us the saints.
Everybody on the line, contend. What does it mean by contend? Or in other words, contend means to be satisfied, that you are not wanting to have more than that. So let's find out what is written by content from our dictionary. Read out. C-O-N-T-N-D. Because some of you may be confused with the word content, because English is not your first language, neither it's my first language. So some of you may be having a problem to understand what does it mean by content. Okay, let's read out C-O-N.
Struggle to someone.
T-E-N-D. What did it say?
Struggle to someone.
Struggle to someone and continue?
Assert something as a position in an argument.
Uh-huh. And what else? Any more meanings been given? Okay? That means to be satisfied, to be contained. In other words, not to be wanting for more. For example, if I have a house and a car, and if God provide me with a beautiful house with a shelter, if I have a sufficient food for my daily survival, I think we ought to be content. And when you are wanting for more, then what do? You committed crimes. And there are many people who want more and more money. God has already provided them a sufficient enough money. And the blessings, being, God gave them the enough blessings, but they're not content with that. And they want more. They're still wanting for more and more and more. As a result, what did they do? They started to do all kinds of evil things. And finally, what happened? They committed crimes, and they would be put in jail for life imprisonment. Because why are they facing those kind of why are they in those kind of situations? Because they are not content in life. God gave them a beautiful family. God gave them a beautiful house. God has provided everything what they need. God gave you all the essential needs that you need in your daily life in order to survive. God gave you the building, a car. God gave you enough sufficient and a blessing, but despite all that, that many people are still wanting for more. And as a result, they committed crimes. So one day, why did they make this mistake in their life? It's because they don't learn to be contained. So contentment is very important. So here exactly what the scripture says in the second epistle of Jude 1:3 is for the Christians, for the Bible believing people like you and me, to be contained. Amen.
Amen.
To be contained with what? The word of God clearly says here, all right, that we should be earnestly contained for the faith or the doctrines which was once delivered unto the saints. Amen. Hallelujah.
Amen.
So if you're wanting for more, that means you are not satisfied with what the scripture says. All right, all things are sufficient. Everything that is needed. If you want to have an answer, if you're looking for an answer, if you're looking for a solution, okay, it's all here in the Holy Bible. But many people are not content with that. But the Word of God says, don't do that. All right, the Word of God clearly says here that it was needful for me to write unto you. So the apostles had acknowledged over here that it was needful, even in the first century. It was needful for me to write unto you and exhort you that you should or ye should earnestly contain for the faith which was once delivered unto the saints. Amen. Hallelujah. So that means if you've never come across all such kind of terms, this triune God, three person, second person, first person, third person, then why should we go along with, you know, and practice and believe in those man-made terms and terminology? And by the way, when we study church history, it's absolutely clear it was adopted. The Catholic Church adopted, they changed the names, but the religions and the doctrine remained the same. It was nothing but a paganism doctrine. It was nothing but a Babylonianism doctrine. The hidden doctrine was made, you know, some kind of whitewashing, giving a policy, giving only the police, making it, you know, shining and beautiful and good. But it's the same doctrine inside, internally, it is the same paganism, Babylonism, the hidden doctrine, religion was modified, and they named it a Catholic. The Roman Catholic faith and Roman Catholic doctrine. So as a result, all the church members in the Catholic Church, they can retain all their religion, they can retain all their doctrines and practices, they can continue to do everything what they have been doing from their forefathers, they can continue to practice every festival, every religion, whatever they believe, only the names are changed. Since the 325 AD. So that's the reason why in the medieval periods, a man called Martin Luther, who grew up himself, he grew up from the Catholic faith, from the Catholic home, and studied in Catholic schools and universities. And he also became consecrated the bishop or the priest, an ordained priest in the Catholic Church. Or he also earned a doctor of theology or a PhD from the Wittenberg University. Such a highly qualified priest, well versed in Greek and Hebrew and Arabic. And I understand Martin Luther was very much well versed with the Bible languages, such as in Hebrew, Greek, and Arabic. Now remember, these are three languages which are very important. Because the spoken language of Jesus Christ was not Hebrew, it was not a Greek, even though he himself, according to flesh, is a Hebrew man. He's a Jewish man. But the spoken language was Arabic. Everybody say Arabic?
Arabic.
Okay? Not Arabic, but Arabic. For example, Eloi, Eloi, that is also Arabic. Maranatha, these are also Arabic, for example. You can see some words in Arabic. That Jesus Christ, the spoken language that he used was the Rami. So therefore many people say the spoken language of Jesus Christ was the Arabic. So therefore many people are so encouraged to learn even Arabic. I said, it's okay if you can learn it. If you have access to learn Arabic, go ahead. But that doesn't mean that he does not know the Hebrew. He also knows the Hebrews. And at his home he might have spoken Hebrew. But during the days of Jesus Christ, when he was here on this earth, the 2,000 years ago, the spoken language that Jesus Christ used was Arabic. So when you talk about Martin Luther himself was well versed with Greek and Hebrew and Arabic. Such a highly qualified priest. So one day he was reading from Romans 1:17 and he came across these words in the Romans 1:17. You can turn the Bible from the Romans 1:17. Check it out, Romans 1:17. What it says there? It clearly says, for therein is in the righteousness of God revealed from faith to faith. As it is written, the just shall live by faith. And from the moment when his eye was stuck with this verse, he changes all his mind and he started raising the questions. So he was so wanting to ask the questions to the Pope of the Catholic Church. Why can't we say the just shall live by faith? Why can't we say faith alone? Why can't we preach it? Why is it needed to collect the money? Why should we, deceive the people by saying that you should practice, you should give offerings and donations, and you should also believe in indulgence, you should also do the penance, give the money, and purchase a salvation ticket, a confirmation ticket for heaven, for your grandparents, for your mother and father, for your brothers and sisters? Why should we do this? Why are we deceiving the people? Why can't the Catholic Church? Why can't the Catholic Church uphold what Paul says in Romans 1:17? And because of these words, the Reformation broke up. But he had no intention necessarily to break himself or to leave the Catholic Church. That was not his intention. His initial intention was to change the Catholic Church, to bring the Catholic Church back to the Bible way, to hold the biblical teachings, to preach that salvation is by faith, not by work. But then the Catholic councils, the Catholics Council was not willing to give even a hearing. They said, we don't believe in that. We believe in traditions. So immediately, they terminated him. His license was revoked. He was expelled. And on the top of that, his life was a threat. If he would not have fled from the Germans, surely he must have been killed. So therefore now we know that Martin Luther is known as the father of the Protestant Church. But wait a minute. Why were the people protesting? What are the reasons for a change? Said, let's return to the Bible way. Let's go back to the Bible teaching. Let's the Bible said like this. It is written in the Bible. Only because of that. But the majority of the people, the crowd, the councils, the Catholic council was not willing to accept them anymore. That means you people are questioning. You are the traitors. Then you are the enemy. You are anti-national, for example. You are the anti-national, you are the anti in the Catholic council. Did that mean you are anti-Catholics? And then they should, a notification saying that these people deserve nothing to be dead because they are empty nationalists. They conspired, they made a conspiracy to destroy the Catholic Church. They are nothing but a traitor. That's the reason why they have to fled away. They have to run for their life. Because otherwise, this holy crusader, Catholics, you know, warriors would surely kill them. They would maybe burn alive, and many people have been burned alive, but you know, even beheaded, they cut up their necks. Some people are even burned alive. Because they are supporting the Bible teaching, that's it. So we are coming back to the same thing. So why is it today, as a Bible-believing Christian, why are we still insisting? According to the Nicene Creed, according to Apostles' Creed, wait a minute, apostles never wrote down those creeds. The creed that you know as Apostle Creed is also written by the Roman Catholic Church. The Roman Catholic wrote Apostle Creed. They may give the name apostles, but it is not by the real apostles. In other words, the other name for the Apostle Creed is the Catholic Creed. The Roman Catholic Creed. In short, that's what it means. And the Creed clearly said, the Catholic faith is this, that the Catholic Church believe in Trinity, Trinity and unity. So once the Catholic Pope, you know, gave an announcement, and he was talking about the Protestant Church, and said, every Protestant church, every so-called Reformation Protestant churches around the world, as long as you believe in the doctrines of Trinity, you are part of the Catholic Church organization and ministry. And therefore he gave thanks, what a thanks that he was appreciating the Protestant Church were still holding the Roman Catholic Trinity. He said, as long as you believe in the doctrine of the Trinity, you still belong to the Catholic Church. You may not be attending the Catholic Mass every Sunday morning, and legally, or in a formality way, you may not be having affiliations with the Vatican anymore, but as long as you uphold and teach the doctrine of the Trinity, you are still part of the Catholic Church. And the Pope himself was given that announcement. And he was right. He was absolutely right. Because as long as you uphold the Roman Catholic Trinity, even officially you may not be aligned, you may not have affiliations anymore with the Catholic Church, but inside, you're still a Catholic Church member because you are still holding the Catholic Church doctrine. For example, if I am not I may not have affiliations with Islam or with the Muslims, but if I would uphold, if I would still teach to my students and to my church member about Muhammad, the Book of Muhammad, if I said this is inspired from God, and if I keep preaching every Sunday morning to all of you that Muhammad is the real prophet, greater than Jesus, then I am not upholding the Bible doctrine. I am upholding Islamic Muslim doctrine. Even if I don't have official aligned affiliations with Islam, but inside I'm still, as long as I hold the Islamic Muslim doctrine, and if I exalt and magnify Muhammad, greater than Jesus, that I'm not preaching the gospel that apostle preached. I'm preaching the gospel that is preached by the prophet Muhammad. That means outside I'm a Christian, inside I'm a Muslim or Islam. You see that? So that is the idea. When the Pope gave an announcement saying that whosoever believes in the Trinity, as long as you believe and practice the Holy Trinity of a Catholic faith, then you are part of the Catholic Church. That's the reason, my friend, the Christ in the Holy Scriptures, come out, O my people, from her. I want you to turn the Bible from Revelation 18. Check it out. The voice of God. Let's hear from the voice of God what God is saying. You want to hear from God's voice? You want to hear the voice of God? Someone give me the answer. Would you like to hear the voice of God?
Yes.
Yes or no?
Yes.
Amen. You want to hear the voice of God? Then turn the Bible with me to Revelation chapter 18, verse 4. Read loud, brother. Amen. Let's hear from Brother Malita. Read loud. Good standing. Let's hear it.
And I heard another voice for heaven, a saying, come up of her, my people that yet be no partaker of her, save.
Okay,
and that yet receive no of her. But I,
okay, yeah. Thank you. So that is what the voice of God, my friend. Amen. Read again. So here John said, I heard another voice from heaven saying, come out of her. Her. Wait a minute. Her is a singular pronoun, but this one is not masculine but feminine. Right? Her. Oh my God. How can the people of God come out from an individual human being called woman? Can I just come out from Sister... Can all the children of God come out from Sister Lanroti? No. So her is referring to organization. Her is referring to another religion. Her is also referring to another denomination. So, we know that the Catholic Church is one of the denominations. Alright? Studied by the Emperor Constantine. So I want you to look it up. I want you to focus here again in Revelation 18, verse 3. For all nations have drunk of the wine of the wrath of her fornication, and the kings of the earth have committed fornication. Underlined. Kings of the earth have committed fornication. With her. With who? With her. They mean all the kings of the earth have committed fornication. Now, fornication means what? In other words, sexual relationship. In other words, fornication means if a married person is having an extramarital relationship, whether a husband or wife is not being faithful to one another, and if a wife or a husband is having a sexual relationship with another man or another woman, and that is called fornication. Are you guys clear now? So here the kings of the earth is referring to the church, referring to you and I. Because who is the King of Kings? Our Lord, hallelujah, our Savior. Amen. Then who are we? We too are kings. Amen. Hallelujah. Okay, in order to make you understand, I want you to turn the Bible to Revelation chapter 1. Focus on verse 6. In order to make you understand who are the kings of the earth, I want you to just urge you to focus on verse 6. Revelation chapter 1, verse 6. And have made us kings and priests unto God and his Father. Underline that. Made us kings and priests. Amen. You see that? John the Apostle himself included when he said, he made us kings. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Clear now? So that means, this us is referring to the church of God. And even John the Apostle included himself and he said, he made us kings and priests. Who is he? Referring to our Lord Jesus. Us here is referring to the church. And he already and Apostle John says that God made us kings and priests. Amen. Hallelujah. So therefore, coming back to Revelation chapter 18, how you can understand the story about, and you can now understand this context very easily. So all this are drunk the wine of the wrath of fornication, and the kings of the earth have committed fornications. Why is it necessary to put the word fornication? Because remember, the moment when you become the church, members of the body of Christ, when you become part of the body of Christ, which is the church, you are spiritually like the bride for the Almighty God. Amen. Hallelujah. Because according to the Bible, spiritually, Christ is our bridegroom and the church is what? The bride. Amen. Hallelujah. Spiritually speaking, the church is the wife of our Lord Jesus. And who is our husband? Jesus Christ is our husband. They were sick in 2 Corinthians. Look at the 2 Corinthians, chapter 11. Verse 2, Apostle Paul said very clearly, and he said, "For I am jealous over you with a godly jealousy, for I have espoused you to the one husband." Do not underline one husband. It does not say, "I have espoused you to three husbands." Amen, hallelujah. If God is a three persons, if we have one God in three persons, if our God is a three separate persons, dwelling as one, but yet three persons, that means we will end up having three husbands, my friend. And some preacher even says, the best example of the Trinity is a wife and husband. Wait a minute. My wife and I, yes, spiritually we are one. So certainly we can say we are one. But practically speaking, physically speaking, we are not one. Because she is another human being and I am another human being, right? So no matter how close I am with my wife, I can never use those phrases, those statements that Jesus Christ often used while he was on the earth. One example is that for about what about John 14, verse 10, because Jesus said, "Whosoever have seen me have seen my Father." Right? So some theologians are saying the best example of Trinity is the wife and husband. Alright? We are one, but yet we are two separate individual human beings. That is very ridiculous. We have a, you know, analogy or a giving example. Because no matter how close we are, we can never say, even we have seen me. I cannot use these phrases or this statement. If you have seen me, you have seen my wife. It is impossible. Therefore, I often make this kind of joke, isn't it? Some of my friends asked me, "Could you please send me or even your wife picture?" And since we are one, and Jesus himself said, "If you have seen me, you have seen my Father," and therefore, say I started taking my own picture, selfie, like this, and I have uploaded it one on my WhatsApp. And as soon as I said, "My wife picture, Zeni Mangte picture." At the moment that brother clicks on that picture, I look like this. Isn't it? I look like and then if I just, on the bottom, if I just wrote some sentences, such as, "If you have seen me, you have seen my wife," will that be acceptable? No, my friend. So therefore, understand, guys, no matter how close we are, we can never say, "If you have seen me, you have seen my wife." Or you cannot say, "If you have seen me, you have seen my husband." Because ultimately speaking, you wife and husband, physically, we are two separate human beings. Okay? But that's not how, in terms of the Father and the sons. Therefore, Jesus Christ could claim that I am the Father, Father is in me. Amen. Hallelujah. He could easily say, "If you have seen me, you have seen my Father," because the deity of Jesus Christ is the Father. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. The Spirit that dwelt in Jesus is not another God, but the Father himself. So in other words, something that is visible to your eyes. What is visible to your eyes, say for example, let's transfer you back to the first century. Let us assume for a moment that you are one of the apostles of Jesus Christ. That let us assume for a moment that you are one of the disciples of Jesus Christ. You have seen with your physical naked eye, and Jesus is standing right behind, in front of you. The flesh and the body that you could see with your eyes is the Son. Amen.
Hallelujah.
But the Spirit, which is invisible, which is in Christ Jesus, which is in the body of Jesus Christ, and this is also everywhere in heaven and earth at the same time, that the Spirit of God is not another God, but the Father Himself.
Amen. Hallelujah.
Now the best example is like, for example, when we look ourselves. If you want to see, if you say, for example, if you say, "Sir, I want to see your spirit. Can I show you my spirit?" I cannot show you my spirit because my spirit is invisible. Now, when we say invisible, that is something not visible. Invisible. All right? And the essence of God is the Spirit of God is invisible. Amen. Hallelujah.
Amen.
And no one can see God because God is invisible. That is part of His attributes. Hallelujah. So, for example, you cannot even see my spirit, but what you can see is my body, my flesh. But if you still insist, if you say, "Sir, I want to see your spirit," no matter what, "I want to see your spirit. How can I show you my spirit? Tell me." Because after all, the spirit is invisible. How can I show you my spirit? The only way that I can say to you is that if you have seen me, if you have seen this body, this picture, you have seen my spirit. Amen. Only that much I can give you, right? Because the spirit is something invisible. And it would be very insane and foolish thing to keep asking and saying, "Show me your spirit," because the spirit is invisible. So in the same way, the term Father refers or indicates, hallelujah, amen, the deity, and therefore you can never see the deity, you can never see God. Praise the Lord, hallelujah. Unless God manifests Himself in some human form, or unless God make Himself revealed in some form, which can be a visible form, in some visible form, you can never see God. Hallelujah. And that the reason why, what you need to understand is that the term Son indicates humanity. But where the term Father is always indicating His deity. And the people who often have a problem understanding, like John 3:17-16, is they're failing to understand the distinction between the Father and the Son and Spirit in the flesh. In the Holy Bible, there is no distinction between the first God and the second God. There is no distinction between another God and another God. For example, when I say another God, I'm not talking about the Father. Because according to the Roman Catholic, they're saying the Father is the first person. The Son is the second person. Alright? So that's how they make distinction. But the biblical make a very clear distinction. And the distinction is only between the Father and the Son. So when you talk about the Father, we are speaking about the deity, the Spirit. When you talk about the Son, we are talking about the flesh. The best example would be Isaiah 9:6. "For unto the child is born, a son is given." So the term child and son indicates to humanity, but where the term Father and mighty God, okay, indicates the deity. Praise the Lord. But then who is the child? Same Jesus. Who is the Son? The same Jesus. Who is the everlasting Father? The same Jesus. Who is the mighty God? The same Jesus. But don't you think there is a big differences between, and it's totally opposite between Son and Father? Amen. How can the Son become Father, Father become the Son? What you need to understand is that it was necessary, alright, for God to shed the blood. But where God does not have the blood, because God is Spirit. Amen. So in order to be our Savior, in order to be our Okay? Savior, it was necessary for God to become man. And therefore, this was the prophecy in Isaiah 96, for unto us a child is born, a son is given. Remember that in the Old Testament, physically the child was not yet born, the son was not yet, okay, manifested in the flesh. But that was the prophecy, and the prophecy of Isaiah 96 was fulfilled in Bethlehem. Amen. So when the fullness of time come, that God did not send another God, but he made himself of nothing, the great God who created the heavens and earth, the God who fills the entire universe, the God who created the heavens and earth, the God of Abraham, Jacob, and Isaac, did not send another God, but he made himself of no reputation. Amen. Hallelujah. And he made himself in the flesh. And that is exactly what the scripture says. And therefore, remember Psalm 3:16 and 17 is physically uttered by not the apostles. Remember these lines and these phrases, these statements. In Psalm 3:16 and 17 is said by Jesus Christ himself. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Now you can see back in front of the case in the Bible. See Psalm 3 again. You can see the John 3:16 and 17, it's all in a red color. So in my King's Bible, John 3:16 and 17, it's all in red color. What does it mean? It simply means that these are the words of Jesus Christ. Amen. So there it's red. Amen. Hallelujah. Now remember, John 3:16 or even 17 is physically spoken by our Lord Jesus Christ from his mouth. Amen. Praise be the name of God. Hallelujah. So here what you understand is that Jesus is here speaking as a man, using the human language. Here the man is speaking. So as a man, he speaks like a man. Amen. Hallelujah. And therefore he said, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. So what did God begate? Is the flesh. Amen. He prepared for himself the body, the flesh. And when the time comes, when full of time was fully come, amen, he made himself of no reputation, and he revealed himself in the form of a servant, or in other words, he manifested himself in that place. Amen. Hallelujah. And then he revealed himself to the world as a son of God, or as a son of man. So therefore you can clearly see over here in verse 17 that Jesus was, for God sent not his son into the world to condemn by the world, but that the world through him might be saved. And therefore what you need to understand is, alright, that God is not sending another God. God is not sending another God, because according to the Bible, God manifests himself in the flesh. So then what does it mean by this phrase or this term send? What does it mean by this send or send? What is the meaning? Alright, it means this is the meaning is very simple. Okay, the word sends indicates, okay, I want you to underline, the word sent indicated God appointed the son for a special purpose. God formed a plant, put flesh on that plant, and then put the plant in operation. So God gave a son a special task. So God manifests himself in flesh in order to achieve a special goal. And therefore, Hebrews 3 element, sorry, Hebrews 3 1 says, alright, called Jesus the apostle of our professors. And the apostles, meaning one sent in Greek. Now, when you study from the Greek text, apostle means one sent. So, briefly stated, the sending of the Son emphasized the humanity of the Son. I repeat myself, the sending of the Son emphasized the humanity of the Son and the specific purpose for which the Son was born. So here the word, according to in the biblical in a context, the word send does not mean that another God is sending another God, not in that sense. Because no one can be equal with God, and there is nothing else beside Him. There is none is like Him. Amen. Hallelujah. So in the biblical context, now the word sin here simply means that God made a special purpose, or God appointed the Son for a special purpose and a special task, and when the fullness of time comes, that God manifested Himself in flesh in order to achieve that special goal. Amen. Hallelujah. So in other words, the invisible God who fills the heavens and the earth, who is an omnipresent God, is now revealing Himself to the mankind, amen, in the human flesh. Praise the Lord. So then, hallelujah, amen, the invisible God becoming or manifesting in the flesh, revealing Himself to the world, to the mankind, as the sons or in the flesh, that is what we need to understand, okay, when it comes to the Son. Okay, the sin, I mean, the word sin here means that the invisible God is now becoming a visible. Praise the Lord, hallelujah. So God is not sending another God. There is no other God. As far as the Holy Scripture is concerned, there is none like Him and none beside Him. Let's turn the Bible to Isaiah to give you more further understanding. Okay, everyone turn the Bible in Isaiah. Isaiah 44, let's turn again. Verse 24 says, thus said the Lord thy Redeemer, and He did form thee from the womb. I am the Lord that maketh all things, that spread for the heavens alone, that spreadeth abroad the earth by myself. I want you guys to underline the words, such as alone, myself. Amen. Hallelujah. That means it is absolutely clear that according to Isaiah chapter 44 and verse 24, the God who created the heavens and the earth, the God who made you and I, the God who created the visible, invisible thrones, dominions, the heavens and the earth, is only one in number. Amen. Hallelujah. Never said alone, myself. Okay? For example, if I made this duster with my wife, I can never take the credit on my own. And the individual, I can never say, I made this duster by myself. For example, I cannot use those kind of phrases. I cannot say, alone I made this duster. How can I say alone? Because when my wife is also involved in producing or in this developing or in this designing, in this painting, or in this coloring, right? In polishing, in cleaning, for example. Even if she's involved, then I can never say, alone I made this duster. I can say, my wife and I, we made this duster. Am I right? Am I right? Hallelujah. So if God, if the Trinity God, if the Triune God were together, the contributing and creating the heavens and earth, then how can only the Father take all the credits, and only how can only Jesus Christ take all the credits in the work of the creation? See, for yourself. Because according to Isaiah 44 in verse 24, you can clearly see that the one true God, the God of Abraham, Jacob, and Isaac, you can see in English it is Lord, capital, YHWH. Because Hebrew does not have a vowel, we call it bubbles. So in the tetragrammaton, we call it YHWH. So exactly, we don't know how it should be pronounced. Therefore, some say Yahweh, some say Jehovah. But by the way, the Hebrew, the all Hebrew form says Yahweh. Now, Jehovah is simply a new Hebrew form. But what you don't understand is still, okay, Yahweh means, or Jehovah means, the God of Abraham, Jacob, and Isaac. We are talking about the one true God. I mean, hallelujah. We are talking about the God of Abraham. Whether you are saying Yahweh or Jehovah, it means the same thing. One is the old Hebrew form, one is the new Hebrew form. But even Yahweh or even Jehovah, even this pronunciation, the sound itself is, okay, it's according to the Jewish, their scholars and priests. Because no one knows exactly how to pronounce it. Are you guys clear? For example, when you say YHWH, how are you going to pronounce it? No vowel over here, right? So YHWH. So some people still prefer to say Yahweh. Anyway, and then here we added the vowel za, and here become Yahweh. A and E is being added over here. Clear now? But then, whether you say Jehovah or whether you say Yahweh, we are talking about the one true God. We are talking about the God of Abraham, Jacob, and Isaac. And the King James Bible always translated as a capital L-O-R-D in a capital letter. So whenever you come across in a capital letter L, capital O, capital R, capital B, capital, what does it mean? What does it mean? It means Yahweh. Amen. Hallelujah. And nobody can deny that. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. So that we can identify, we can understand that this verse is talking about the God Abraham, Jacob, and Isaac. So now listen carefully and focus your eyes again on verse 24. Thus says the Lord, you can underline. Thus says the Lord, L-O-R-D. All in the capital letters, right? Then in other words, thou say Yahweh. So Yahweh is saying over here. Thy Redeemer, he has formed thee from the womb. That means our maker. He said, I am. The Lord, that I am Yahweh, that made it all things, that spread for the heavens alone, that spreadeth abroad the earth by myself. Wait a minute. Here it says, Yahweh takes all the credit, and he said, all by myself and alone I have created the heavens and the earth. So according to the Old Testament, there is only one, absolutely one God, Yahweh alone, created the heavens and the earth. Clear now? Amen. Hallelujah. Then, if you look at the New Testament, that Jesus Christ takes all the credit when it comes to creating the heavens and the earth, visible, invisible, thrones, dominant. Everything is created by Jesus. All things are created by Jesus and for Him. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. What does it tell you? It means that the ultimate Yahweh, the one true God, is simply the New Testament Jesus. And still, if you don't have that understanding, then I don't know what to do. That means you need to give it up all your man-made doctrines and knowledges that you have already, alright, learned in your previous school and your previous studies. unless and until you empty yourself. All right, in order to learn God's word, my friend, you need to first empty yourself. You need to free yourself. If you always, all right, learn God's word with the doctrines, with the that man-made doctrines that you have already learned in your previous seminary or in your previous studies, and in that glass or in that speck, if you read it, the Holy Scriptures, no matter how clear it may be. Now let me give you one example. Without emptying yourself of your previous knowledge, if you simply stick with the Bible, without emptying yourself with the previous knowledge, if you read the Bible, no matter how many times you may read, how many times you may study, it will not be difficult, it will be difficult for you to understand. The reason is, let me give you one example. Say for example, thank God that this is a white glass. This is a white optical. But this is not a sunglass. I have some eye, my power is a little bit less. It's a little bit weaker, so therefore I need this glass in order to see far distances, okay, in a very clear picture. So now, instead of this glass, if I would put a sunglass, because every sunglass has a color, right? Either black or blue or red or whatever. So if I would put up a black sunglass, and with that if I would read the Bible, or with that if I would read any book, no matter how many times, or no matter how sincere I may be studying, whatever I study will be black. If my sunglass, its color is red, then no matter what I studied, everything that I see will be red. Am I right? Am I right, my friends? Everything that I view, everything that I, what I'm seeing, everything will be red or either black. If my sunglass is red, everything will be red. If my sunglass is black, everything will be black. This is the problem. This is the problem with the so-called learned theologians, or some senior pastors and Bible teachers, because they're not willing to give it up, their previous name doctrine. They are not willing to just empty themselves and stick with the biblical teaching. Because as long as, if you still keep your previous name doctrines, the doctrine that you've learned in your previous studies or Bible studies or in previous schools, unless you, until you give it up, no matter how many times I may preach to you, how many times you may go for systematically, intensively biblical classes, it may be not easy for you to understand. So therefore, in our here at ABTS, we say ABTS, where the Bible is a textbook. Because the moment when we allow denominational teachings to creep into our classes, and when we are allowing the denominational views and doctrines to be implemented over here, then we will not be able to understand what the Bible's doctrine is. It will not be easy for us to understand the truth, the sound biblical truth. So therefore we are just sticking with the Bible word. And just for a study guide, we are giving you a study materials. Even the study material is 100% based on Bible alone. Amen. Hallelujah. We are not, therefore, not quoting from other opinions. We are not, you know, depending on any other religious, doctrinals, theological notes, and explanations. We stick with the Bible alone. Now let's come back again to the point that I'm just trying to let you know. So therefore, according to the Bible, then Isaiah 44 verse 34, it's absolutely clear that God who created the heavens and the earth is only one God. And His name is Yahweh, according to the Old Testament. And according to the New Testament, we can see, when it comes to the creation, that Jesus Christ alone had created the heavens and the earth. He alone takes all the credits. And the Bible clearly says that he created all things and is created for him. Amen. Created by him. Say, created by him. Louder, created by him. And for him. Nowhere it says created by him and for them. Or it does not say created by his father and for him. No. It says created by him and for him. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. So therefore you need to understand that John 3:16-17 does not mean that another God is said another God. It simply means that God the Father, the God who created the heavens and the earth, when the fullness of the time come, he manifested himself in the flesh. So he gave of himself, or in other words, God the Father gave of himself. He did not send someone else. Amen. Hallelujah. Therefore, Apostle Paul declaring in 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 19, God was in Christ. Amen. Hallelujah. Who is the Father? Father is God. Who is God? God is the Father. So in other words, the Father was in Christ, revealing himself to the world. The Son was sent from God as man, not as God. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. So therefore, you need the word, in a biblical term, the word send simply means that, hallelujah, amen, the Son was sent from God as a man, not as God. Therefore, in Augustine chapter 4, verse 4 also says, God sent forth his sons made of a woman. So the word send does not imply pre-existent. Please understand that. Hallelujah. Everybody understand this. The word sent does not imply pre-existence of the sons or pre-existence of the man. Amen. Hallelujah. So please keep in your mind that the word sent in the biblical terms, not in the Catholic definitions, but in the biblical term, that you need to understand that the word sent does not imply the pre-existence of the sons or the pre-existence of the men. Therefore, John chapter 1 verse 6 states that, so therefore in John chapter 1 verse 6 also says that John the Baptist was a man sent from God. But we all know that John the Baptist, he did not pre-exist his conception. I want you to turn the Bible. Let's have a look at it from the Gospel of John 1, 6. Let's read out. Look at here. John chapter 1 and verse 6. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. Amen. His name is John. The Baptist is the title because that's what he do. Baptizing people at the Jordan River. So therefore, according to John 1:6, we can clearly understand that John the Baptist was a man sent from God. But we all know, my friends, that John the Baptist did not pre-exist his conception. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. So that means, sent here does not is indicating, the word sent is not indicating that God the Father, another God, is sending another God. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. So always understand, the word sent always indicates that God appointed the sons for a special purpose. So when the fullness of time come, he manifested himself and he fulfilled that special task by himself. Amen. Hallelujah. That's what it means. So therefore, my friends, I want you to underline it, this one. Then I'll also read out in Isaiah before we wind up for today. Isaiah 43 and verse 11. Okay, Isaiah chapter 43 and verse 10 and 11. Let's read out together. Let's all be read together.
Ye are my witnesses, says the Lord, and my servant whom I have chosen. Let him know and believe me, and I have said that I am he. Before me there was no platform, they will shelter me after me. I am Lord, and aside me there is no savior.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. So therefore, my friend, it's a very clear, according to Isaiah 43, verse 10, that ye are my witnesses, saith the Lord, and my servant whom I have chosen, that he may know that I believe and understand that I am he. Before me there was no before, and neither shall be after me. Then how can we say that God exists in two or three persons? Because this Bible verse does not allow it. It is impossible for God to be more than one. Amen. Hallelujah. So therefore, what did God say here? I am he, and before me there was no God, for, and neither shall be there be after me. Look at in verse 11. So therefore, the creator of the heavens and earth, Yahweh, said, I am the Lord, that when I am Yahweh or Jehovah, and beside me, there is no savior. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. So that means according to the Old Testament, that Yahweh alone or Jehovah alone is a savior. But put your finger over here and read out from Luke chapter 2. Let us see according to the New Testament who is a savior. Luke chapter 2 and verse 10. And 11. Let's read out together. Luke chapter 2 verse 10 and 11. Now you tell me in the New Testament who's the Savior and what is his name. Luke chapter 2 verse 10 and 11. Are you guys there?
Yes.
Okay, read it out. Thank you.
And the angel said unto them, fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of joy, which shall be to all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord.
Amen. Hallelujah. So when you simply allow the Bible to interpret the Bible, when you simply allow the Scripture to interpret the Scripture, then you can clearly understand, my friend, that the God or the Savior who spoke in Isaiah 43 and verse 11, the Almighty God, the God who said, I am the Lord, I am Yahweh. Beside me there is no Savior. The Savior of the Old Testament, the God of the Old Testament, the God of the Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. The God of Abraham, Jacob, and Isaac said, I am Yahweh, and beside me there is no other Savior. So that means according to the entire Old Testament, there is only one Savior, and his name is Yahweh. Amen. Hallelujah.
Amen.
But when you study here in Luke chapter 2, verse 10 and 11, the angel said unto them, fear not, for behold, I bring good tidings of a great joy which shall be to all people. In verse 11, for unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. Amen. You see? There is only one Savior. And the God of Abraham, Jacob, and Isaac said, I am the Savior. And there is no other Savior. But when you compare that with Luke chapter 2, verse 10 and 11, you can clearly understand that the Savior is born. Hallelujah. And revealed himself as a son and was born as a baby in a Bethlehem. Praise the Lord. Amen. Hallelujah. Hear now? So therefore, my friend, understand. The Old Testament Yahweh, or the Old Testament God, the God of Abraham, Jacob, and Isaac, is truly the New Testament, Jesus Christ. Therefore, the word send here never means that God is sending another God. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah.
Amen.
So therefore, does this mean that Jesus, the Son of God, is a separate person from the Father? Does it go to John 3:17 and John 3:16 says, Sam, does this mean, or does this mean that Jesus Christ is a separate from the Father? We know that according to the Bible, it is absolute no. Because we know that this is not so, because according to the New Testament, the Bible clearly teaches that God manifested himself in flesh. Therefore, he did not send another God. Amen. So therefore, the word send here simply means that God, hallelujah, amen, appointed the Son for a special purpose. Now, when you talk about the Son here indicates the humanity. Amen. Hallelujah. So what we also need to come and always keep in mind is that, all right, God formed a plant and put a flesh on that plant and then put the plant in the prison. So God gave the Son a special task. So God manifests himself in flesh in order to receive that special goal. So when the fullness of time came, he did not send another God, but he emptied himself, or he made himself a glorification and fulfilled that plan which has already existed in his mind before the foundations of the world. Amen. Hallelujah. Alright? In conclusion, I want you to read your Bible in Philippians chapter 2. Philippians chapter 2, let's read verse 7. But made himself of no reputation. Made himself. Nobody made him. Nobody forced him. Nobody sent him separately. So therefore, Philippians chapter 2, verse 7, 26. Made himself. Amen. That means no other God forced him or sent him or directed him. Praise the Lord, hallelujah. He made himself of no reputations. The Greek word for this is keno or kenosis. In other words, it means that he emptied himself. But that doesn't mean that God emptied or God sacrificed all his deity. He's always the same yesterday, today, forever the same. He never emptied his attributes and his deity. Even when he was manifested in the flesh, was born in Bethlehem. Amen. Hallelujah. But he did not exercise it because he came to fulfill the old covenant, the law. And therefore, Jesus did not exercise the power. He didn't exercise his, the great authority and power until he was baptized at the Jordan River. And therefore, you can see that after Jordan River only, Christ began to exercise his power and authority. Amen. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. So that's what it means. So according to Philippians 2:7, it does not mean that he emptied or he gave up all his deity and his power. Not in that sense. It means that he humbled himself to this extent that he voluntarily, humbled into this extent to the very, very, a lowly category in the lowly positions. And he made himself of no reputation and took upon himself a form of a servant and made himself in the likeness of men. Amen. That's what it means. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. So therefore, Paul declares it in Philippians chapter 2, verse 7, made himself of no reputation. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. I'm not in my throne. This is what the Bible said. I'm not in my throne. Amen. Hallelujah. And then nobody sent him. So don't ever think that another God is sending another God. Not in that sense. So if you're saying another God is sending another God, then what about the Father? Are you saying this is the first person? How can the Father send? Because when Jesus himself said, I am the Father. How can the Father send? Right? Jesus Christ, when Jesus said, the Father is in me. And then Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6 said, he is the everlasting Father. And according to Colossians chapter 2, verse 9, the Father is in Jesus Christ. All the roles and the prerogative, the attributes of the Father is in Christ Jesus. Because Colossians 2:9 said, in Him, in Christ dwelleth all the fullness of the Godhead bodily, including the role of the Father. Amen. Hallelujah. Think about it. Therefore, understand, sin does not mean another God is sending another. It simply means that God put the plan. Amen. Hallelujah. He made him, he plans. He have a great special task. He have a, amen, a special purpose. He has a great plan. And when the full of time come, he fulfilled that plan by himself. Amen. Hallelujah. That's what it means according to the Bible. So therefore, many times that Christians, brothers and sisters, we all are confused. We all are confused. We fail to understand the distinction between the Father and Son. Now remember, one example finally I want to give you before we wind up here is about John chapter 14, verse 28. My Father, He is greater than I. So if you don't understand biblical distinctions, what does it mean by the distinction between the Father and the Son? If you don't have the biblical understanding, then you will end up having a problem. And many theologians and pastors fail to give the biblical explanations for the Bible distinction between the Father and the Son. As a result, many people left the church and joined the movement or the religion or the denomination called Jehovah's Witnesses. Because according to Jehovah's Witnesses, Jesus is not God, He's just a Michael the Archangel. He's one of the angels of God. He's the chief angel, but He's not God. So according to Jehovah's Witnesses, they're saying that only Yahweh, and they don't want to say Yahweh, they say Jehovah, because Jehovah's Witnesses was formed, originated not from Jerusalem, not from Israel, but from America. And therefore, the American people, English people, you know, they prefer to use the Jehovah, which is a new Hebrew form, and they really call themselves Jehovah's Witnesses. And the scripture, they often quote it from Isaiah 43, verse 10 to 11. On the basis of Isaiah 43, verse 10 to 11, the Jehovah's Witnesses form. Charles T. Russell, yeah, if I'm not wrong, the founder name. Anyway, let's keep it aside. So why is it many people converted or left the Bible churches or many evangelical churches? And why is that many people join to the Jehovah's Witness Church? Because many of our pastors failed to give a satisfactory explanation, and they failed to understand the biblical interpretations and biblical explanations of the Father and the Son, and the distinction between the Father and the Son. As a result, many of the people every year got converted into, Christians are being converted into Jehovah's Witnesses. Because Jehovah's Witnesses will say, see, we were right. They said the Father is now referring to Jehovah, and Jesus is here proclaiming, He acknowledges, and Jesus declared that my Father, which is Jehovah, is greater than me. So, and for the Roman Catholic positions, these Bible verses also destroy the credibility of the doctrines of Trinity. Because the Trinity doctrine also says the Father, the Son, no one is inferior, no one is superior. Right? The Father is 100% God, then the Son is 100% God. The Father is 100% Almighty, then the Son is also 100% Almighty. If the Father is uncreated, the Son is uncreated. If the Father is omnipresent, the Son is omnipresent. If the Father is only sign, the Son is also only sign. So they are equal in power from eternity. Right? Brother Leru? Correct? Then how would you interpret this then? Because if you don't understand the distinction between the Father and the Son, you will always have a problem. Because Jesus himself acknowledged, he said it from his mouth, my Father is greater than me. Was Jesus right? Yes, he was absolutely right. Then what kind of distinction is Christ drawing over here? Is Christ making distinction between the Father and the sons? Another God? No, my friend. Here, distinction is between, as I said before, is between the flesh and the spirit. Amen. Hallelujah. And never many times you say the flesh is weak, but the spirit is willing. Amen. Hallelujah. What did Jesus say to his disciples? The flesh is weak, the spirit is willing. Right? So therefore, when Jesus said, my Father, he's referring to his deity, and when he said, I, he's referring himself to humanity. Amen. So now, I just give it to you to tell me. Is it the humanity and the divinity? Which one is greater? Obviously, the divinity is greater. Amen. Now you tell me, is it the flesh and the spirit? Which one is greater? The spirit is obviously greater than the flesh. Amen. Hallelujah. So therefore, many times what we fail to understand is this. Okay, making the distinguishing between, okay, the term the Father and the Son. So what we understand here is, when you talk about the Father, the term Father here indicates about the divinity. And when you talk about the Son, it is referring to his humanity. Amen. Praise the Lord. So therefore understand that Jesus said, my Father is greater than I. Therefore understand one thing. The Spirit cannot die, but the Son can die, the flesh can die.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Are you guys here now?
Yes.
Humanity can die, but divinity cannot die. That was the reason why Jesus said, my Father is greater than I. So this additional knowledge that I want to just add it over here, the rest we'll discuss it later on. Amen. Hallelujah. My time is up right here, and thank you very much, guys. God bless you, and may you be blessed in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. So remember all this, the Father and the Son. Father indicates divinity. The Son indicates humanity. The distinction between not God and other God is between them. Divinity and humanity is between the spirit and the flesh. Praise the Lord. Amen. Let's all stand together. Okay, let's sing one chorus a little bit here. Praise the Lord, can we sing this song together on the page number? Yes, the days of Elijah. Can you sing? A little bit? Amen. Hallelujah.
Yeah, yeah.
These are the days of Elijah. Hallelujah. Amen.
Heaven's watching. Song number, please.
Page number 3, or song number 6. Days of Elijah. Okay, you leave because I have some short problem.
Yeah.
Okay, Brother Leon.
Let me pray. Thank you, God, for giving us, oh Father, this wonderful time, oh Father, as well. We have sitting, oh Father, here in the class, oh Father, whatever we learn from this class, oh Father, may you give us more wisdom to gain, oh Father, so that whatever we learn, Lord Father, we may be applying into our life, Lord Jesus, so that we may be able to apply and serve you, Lord Father, Lord Jesus. I also pray for
this
evening group to the Father, our principal, Lord Father. I pray for him, Lord Father, whatever he had taught us, Lord Father, may you bless us continuously so that he may be able to teach and even the day to come, Lord Father, Lord Jesus, Lord Father, according to your will, Lord Father. Now we are going to depart from this place, Lord Father. May you continuously be with us and guide us till we come back in this class, Lord Father, Lord Jesus. And may you help us and guide us, Lord Father. Everything I submit this prayer into my hand. In Jesus' precious name I pray.
Amen.
Thank you, guys. Thank you very much.